Welcome to Show and Tell with the Two Mortgage Guys. We come to you live every Tuesday on Facebook, YouTube, LinkedIn, and Twitter. Today we've got Michael Mygrant with us from Mygrant Realty and Appraisals. Stick around.
So Michael's a lot. Not one, but two intros today. All right, so Michael's a licensed realtor and certified residential appraiser in Kokomo, and he's the owner of Mygrant Realty and Appraisals. He's lived in Kokomo for the majority of his life and graduated from high school in 2000 and at IU Kokomo in 2003. He's married to Heather and has two boys, Isaiah, who is four, and Deacon, who's one. Welcome to the show, Michael.
Thanks, guys. Thanks for having me.
You're welcome. Good to have you on.
For a long time, I've wanted to spend a Valentine's Day with the two mortgage guys. Now, today's the day, so it's
there
a good day.
Yeah.
I'm glad you noticed that. hopefully that wasn't a real wish list item of yours.
It's good to be with you, nonetheless, no doubt.
Well, we joked around before we started that we want to make the subject of appraisals as fun as we can. But, you know, the truth is there's a lot of misunderstandings about home appraisals, how they work, just a lot to talk about, really. So let's kind of get into it. You know, start out by telling us maybe what are you seeing today in today's market out there in the appraisal world?
So, you know, you see a lot of national stats that home prices are under pressure. In some of these super hot markets, values are down 10 to 20%. But in our market, we're not seeing that pressure on values like they are in other bigger metropolitan areas. So I recently pulled stats on from 2021 to 2022, and values are actually up significantly in Howard County. And really, it's a good reminder how real estate's very local. I think what's happened is that the low inventory numbers in our area has kept prices up. So it's interesting to see as interest rates go up and different things happen in the broader market, will we eventually see pressure on home prices that we just aren't seeing that yet from my perspective?
Yeah, that's good to hear.
Yeah, it seems like it's fairly stable, right? I saw the same thing with other LOs we know in other areas across the United States that we saw some of them drop a little bit more. So it seems like, you know, Indiana historically has always sort of been level. They don't jump real high or drop real quick. So it's probably helped us a little bit on that one as well.
And I think I would agree that prices have stabilized. And that's what I'm putting in my appraisals, that prices are stabilized. I would say over the last few years, they're stabilizing at a high level for our area. But we're not seeing crazy increases now, but we're stabilized at a really high level. And I even looked at inventory numbers this morning, and it's below 100 again if you look at available homes in Howard County. Now, there's a whole bunch that are pending, but if you look at available homes in Howard County, the ones that me and you could go out right now and purchase because there are just no offers or anything, the number's below 100, which is a super low number. Right. I would think a balanced market is closer to like 300 maybe homes on the market in our area. So inventory just low, and it's kept prices strong.
Right, and I agree, because that's what I was going to say, is probably 300 to 400. I can remember it being over 600 before, you know, years ago. So to have it below 100, yeah, like you said, that is pretty low. But it is a lot higher than what it was maybe May or June when it dropped down to like almost single digits in some areas.
Yeah, I saw below 30 at the trough in the last year and a half. And I've seen it recently, really just in the last 3 to 6 months, there was a time that we were at 180 that were available. So we went up, and I've seen it, the inventory's kind of come back down. So you know, some of this stuff, it's very unpredictable. I think the seasonality of the market's kind of brought like in those winter months has decreased inventory some. A lot of people don't want to move in the winter. And so there's a little bit of seasonality to the fact that we've come back down from the 180 mark. But yeah, it's fascinating to watch from my perspective how inventories fluctuate.
We'll snap out of that. You know, we'll get a boost of them here as the weather starts to turn. And at least that's what we're telling all of our pre-approved clients out there that are frustrated because they can't find what they want. But it is definitely seasonal. Hey, let's talk about, you know, explain how, in a nutshell, how home values are calculated. Because honestly, this is pretty misunderstood. I know how I explain it to people as far as, you know, looking at homes that have recently sold. But you know, in your words, what's the easiest way to explain how appraisal values are calculated?
So let's go back even further. What exactly an appraiser does, their main role is to give an opinion. And I really, really want to emphasize the word opinion. Of value. And it's often confused with what a home inspector does. Inspector's main role is to, they're hired by a buyer to look at the home's condition. They really don't dive into value too much. They may spend a couple hours at the house, look at the furnace, look at the foundation in detail. Where an appraiser, we go to the house and we look at some condition stuff, certainly, but our main role is value. And really the question with the lender hiring us to go out, the main question the lender wants to be answered is the home worth what the buyer is purchasing it for? And when I'm looking at my approach to an appraisal, really, I receive the order from the client, whether it's LeaderOne or a local bank or whatever. And then I would schedule an appointment to go out and see the home, typically take 20 minutes inside a house, up to an hour, depending on how complex it is to measure. And while I'm there, I look at condition, take some notes, some photos, measure it. And oftentimes the measurements are different than what the assessor website shows. So I confirm all those measurements. And then really the real time comes in writing the report. And a lot of people that's been around in real estate, we've heard people say location, location, location. And I do think without a doubt that location is the number one factor in a appraised value. And it kind of goes back to the idea, most often a smaller home located in South Florida on the beach is going to be worth more than a larger home in North Central Indiana. So location is the number one factor I look at. And I really start, when I start the appraisal process, I start very narrow. So close proximity to the home, homes built in a similar era, homes that are very similar size. So it's kind of the opposite of a funnel that starts wide and goes narrow. I start super narrow to see what homes have sold for in the subdivision. If there's a similar home, I put that into my sales comparison grid and make adjustments to try to come up with an opinion of value. But really, I need to support values, or what my opinion is should be easily supported based on the comparables and the adjustments I make. So it should be well supported on paper.
Well, that's good. I like your analogy with that funnel, that you're taking it from the small part wide instead of the wide part small. So in some of that, is that similar to like some of the online valuations, Zestimates or something? Is it the opposite where it's just taking everything from an area and then spitting something out smaller?
So that's a really good question there. So obviously Zillow, there's no one from Zillow ever comes to your house to walk through it, right? Sure. So they have where it's two stories or a story and a half. The assessor never goes in the house either. So they kind of just draw a conclusion based on what they see from the exterior. So Zillow will look at square footage as the main characteristic that they use in coming up with their Zestimates. Now, they would look at more of a blanket approach on a mile radius or whatever they do, and try to use analytics to come up with a reasonable range of values. And sometimes, like we talk about, if it's a larger subdivision where a lot of the homes are very similar to each other, and if it's a single family home, then they're more likely to be accurate. But the larger the home, if they have second stories, and the homes are all different within the subdivision, I think there's more likely to be some variation in what the Zestimate shows and what an appraiser's opinion of value would be.
That's good. That's awesome. That's a really good explanation of how that pulls that information together.
I always summarize for people that, you know, it's the appraiser is going to try to find other homes that are similar to this house that are close by that have recently sold. Right. And that's kind of, you're like, those are the easy ones. So if you've got three homes in your neighborhood that are comparable to yours and they just sold, that's as easy as it probably gets for you. That's not always the case in these smaller communities. You know, we don't always have that. And therefore you've got to go out further and look in comparable neighborhoods and that kind of stuff. What are the differences in determining that between, let's say, conventional financing and a government loan, like an FHA or VA?
So the process as far as like making the adjustment and pulling comps is identical. So nothing changes from the valuation standpoint. Really the biggest difference is on those government loans like FHA, USDA, there are specific guidelines that those loan products, they want appraisers to look for. And a lot of that stuff typically is related to safety type stuff. It's like, for example, when I'm doing an inspection on a property, if it's an FHA, USDA loan, those loan types don't want to see lead-based paint. And that's probably the number one condition that's made on those loan types is the concern for lead-based paint. So if I see that, then I would simply make a condition and have that repaired. And then hopefully that's the only thing and they can paint it. And then all of a sudden it meets FHA, USDA guidelines. And the thing about lead-based paint, any home built prior to 1978 most likely has lead-based paint, but it's always a concern if it's peeling paint and then when a child ingests it. So whoever made the guidelines up, like the federal guidelines, they're concerned about safety type stuff largely on those type loans. The other thing that I see a lot, like missing handrails, broken glass, maybe if a window's cracked, the septic and well distances. If it's a USDA loan and located in a very rural area, some of those septics and wells are very old. And when they were installed, there wasn't like modern code related to those items. So they may be closer than in proximity to each other than FHA and USDA allows. And FHA and USDA, they want those things 10 feet off the property line and greater than 75 feet apart. Obviously with the septic, you don't want your septic field leaching into your drinking water. Right. And that's the premise of that. So again, those FHA, USDA, it gives me versus conventional, there are just more things that I look at while I'm at a house, mainly related condition and safety. And I use the HUD 4000.1 guidebook to kind of guide me and determine what FHA and USDA are looking for on their loans.
More safety concerns, right?
And then, absolutely.
You know that chipped and peeling paint? Steve used to eat those as a small child, and he turned out just fine.
He turned out wonderfully, didn't he?
Like when they get ready to put their house maybe on the market to sell it, what sort of gives somebody maybe the most bang for their money if they're going to do something? Is it like painting? Is it the curb appeal side of it? Or is it something more on the inside of the house that might be able to be a little more substantial for them with a return on their investment?
So from a valuation standpoint, we talked about location being the number one factor always. And then I think 2A and 2B really is condition and gross living area, so square footage. So I think condition is a huge factor in valuation end of the day. speaking to underwriters and reading what Fannie Mae is looking for, I think that kitchens and bathrooms are always a big, kitchens and bathrooms, you get great value in updating kitchens and bathrooms. Now, I would also say that in these markets where we've been doing this market where the last few years where inventory has been so incredibly low, there is there's less you have to do to a home as far as extensive stuff, extensive remodel in order to sell it. Because the bottom line is from a seller's perspective, the market's kind of been in your advantage. I remember 10 years ago flipping a house, and it was a $150,000 house somewhere in that area. And I put granite in it to set it aside from other houses I was competing with. Whereas the same house now, I probably would just use a laminate countertop. So that just kind of goes back to how inventory affects values. But without a doubt, I think that painting and flooring, along with kitchen and bathrooms, go the farthest in from the buyer's perspective. And just values in general, as far as getting bang for your buck. Because relatively, if you're willing to do the work yourself, you can do flooring and paint for relatively cheaply. And it could have a huge effect on value.
So on the square footage part of it, it's not that you're stuck with your square footage. I mean, obviously you can add on, but as far as in square footage that's already there, that's maybe unimproved. So for example, if you've got access to, like my house, for example, I've got an attic space above the garage. It's totally accessible through a bedroom. If I wanted to put a doorway in, you could walk right into that attic space. That attic space was not counted in my square footage. But if I put a door in, then do I need to improve that space? I mean, does it have to, you know, for you to suddenly count that extra, you know, whatever that room size is into the equation, what's it have to have?
So floors, walls, heating and cooling is, or not, maybe not cooling, but heating for sure. Mm-hmm. There has to be heating in there. And then it has to have some kind of flooring and some kind of walls with paint on it. And that, in what I see sometimes, and I kind of have this debate at houses sometimes within myself, is I see these enclosed patios that they're finished nicely and they're finished in the same quality as the rest of the house, but they don't have a heat source. So if they don't have this heat source, that really limits how often you can use it. So I wouldn't, in that case, consider it square living space, where if it had a heat duct and you could use it 12 months a year, it makes a big difference. So in your case too, Ryan, like if you were going to sell your house and you were debating, should I finish this room or not? I would really lie on what the comps in your neighborhood are doing. And I say that meaning if say that would add an additional 500 square feet to your house, well, are most of the houses in your subdivision, are they closer to that square footage where you need the 500? Or do most of the comps as your current square footage without that addition, are they in that neighborhood of square footage? So I always like, from a seller's perspective, letting the market and specifically what an appraiser would use as a comparable to dictate what you do. Does the homes that are selling in my subdivision, are they using granite, or what type of floor do they have, or have they not really been updated at all, or what's the size of those things? To me, those are the big factors in making those decisions, whether you want to like finish that space out or not.
Sure. Yeah. You brought up a good point on like we have a sunroom. Okay. So we have a sunroom off the back of the house and it's furnished. It's got nice flooring in it, but there's no heat or air in it. So that square footage is not calculated then?
I would not calculate that. No, because really you might go out there for a cigar every now and then, but when it's dead of winter or brutal hot in the summer, it really limits how much you could use that space.
Yeah.
Right. You can't just get, whereas if it had heat and cooling, you get 12 months a year out of that space. And it really, it adds a lot more value to you personally and to your family.
So then that turns that into like that Four Seasons room then. So then that's where you guys look at that and say, now that's a completely new living area.
Right. So then it would go from my perspective, from an enclosed patio, to a finished sunroom. That is part of the living space, the gross living area. So it would be calculated along with the rest of the living area, which would be a more value than just valuing it as an enclosed patio, typically.
Right.
That's pretty cool because, you know, now you can justify spending the money. If I wanted to do a separate heating, air conditioning unit, you know, for that room, I might get some of that money back in overall home value.
Yeah, you might be able to get more bang for your buck on that than finishing the upstairs unfinished room area with the adding the 500 square foot on it.
It'd be cheaper, right? Because All I have to do is provide a heat source out there.
Yeah, that's interesting stuff. Hey, because that brings up so much stuff, Michael, when you're going on that. But I was just thinking like basements, same thing, below grade, same thing that's not really calculated into square footage. But did I read something a while back that now, like, if it's livable or something, you can count it as livable space for something? You're starting to be a little bit less on that if it's, like, maybe finished a little bit?
So when I submit an appraisal and a buyer sees it, or say I'm going out on an appraisal for an estate or whatever the circumstance is, when the person sees my appraisal, a lot of times they question why the basement square footage isn't wrapped up into with the main living area. And what I tell them, if you look at the appraisal, the gross living area, which would be everything above grade that's finished, is calculated on one line. Whereas if you look below that, the basement square footage is calculated. So they're getting credit for the basement, but it's just calculated on a separate line.
There you go.
And part of that goes back to Fannie Mae type rules or what suggestions are made based on my understanding of what Fannie Mae is looking for. And with Fannie Mae, you know, they buy, don't you think like 70 or 80% or more of mortgages eventually end up in Fannie Mae's hands, would you say?
Yeah, I would.
And because of that, it's such a high percentage that they eventually reach their hands. They kind of get to dictate the playing field in a sense. So from my perspective and what I've read, that they do need to be separated areas. And then the question then is the basement square footage finished with the same quality as the main level? Is the basement square footage as livable as the main level? Like, is it, you know, some basements are super damp and many aren't. Is it finished with drywall and TVs and is it all done similar to the main level? And that, how that question is answered will determine how their value, because if it's a super nice walkout basement, and it's just as livable as the main level, any adjustments I make between with the above grade square footage in the basement, the number I used, the amount I used to adjust, it'll be similar for the main level and basement if they're finished with the same quality. Whereas, you know, you could put a super cheap flooring in and it could be damp and it could be paneling in the basement where the upper level is done really nicely, but because they're not finished with the same quality, I just won't make the same adjustment for the main level and lower level square footage.
Makes total sense.
I'm
always interested in what people can do what people can do to add value to their homes, right? Above and beyond just improving the overall features of the property, you know, whether that be flooring or whatever. But I love the idea of trying to tap into additional space to have finished square footage. Cause like you said, square footage, that's number two, right? Number two on overall value size of your home. So pretty cool.
Yeah. Cool stuff. Michael, this has been awesome. Like, we've been able to get a lot of stuff out of that. So we really appreciate you taking a little bit of time out of your schedule to spend with us and to help educate us a little bit and the listeners on it. So if you guys have questions, put them in the comments, but make sure you like and share this. It's got all kinds of stuff in there, appraisal wise, and actually just really about houses in its own. So thanks again. I'd love to have you back on at a later date to cover some more topics on it.
Thank you guys very much. And one thing I wanted to mention, just appreciate you guys as far as like your customer service to mortgage guys. And then particularly the partner you are with Bridges Outreach. I'm on the board at Bridges. You guys are a good neighbor as far as proximity, but then what you guys do with Hogging the Block and how you support Bridges financially, it's so appreciated. And I tell you guys are making a difference for Bridges. So thank you guys.
Thanks. Yeah, we appreciate sharing that.
Yeah, that's good to hear. Our pleasure too. Thanks for joining us today.
All right, thank you.
All right, so next week, we're going to be talking with Jeremy Goldsmith. He's a financial wellness specialist at BMO Harris. Credit is not rocket science, but they sure don't teach you this stuff in school. We're going to be discussing everything from building your credit from scratch to improving your scores, what to do, not to do, all things credit. Don't miss this one. We'll see you next Tuesday at noon.